All right, so we're going to talk about design fundamentals today. And so part of this will be just a look at sort of the engineering design process ever so briefly. More of this is a little bit more informal sort of advice based on what I've seen through the years, both in my own work experience and experience seeing students work on senior projects. So some of this is just advice. It's not a formal treatment, but it's I want to at least know that you hear me, so there will be a quiz. All right, so first of all, you should be aware that engineering design happens sort of in a process. And depending on who you ask, this process has a different number of steps, but in general, I think this is a pretty good way to look at it. You need to understand the problem. Identify the problem and understand what are the constraints. And it seems like maybe constraints sound like they are going to hold you back, but it's actually the constraints that drive you forward. All right. So the more you know about the constraints, the better job and the easier your job as a designer becomes. A lot of design work is running down what are the constraints. So identify the problem and brainstorm possible solutions. Sometimes this happens as an individual, sometimes this happens as a group. But it's good to generate ideas. And generally, it's a good idea if you get information from as many people as possible. And we'll talk about that a little bit more later. Don't rule out anything at the beginning stages as being too ridiculous. But at some point, you need to start to eliminate, evaluate some of the proposed solutions and see what makes the most sense in this context. Be careful about assumptions at this point, but I'll say at the brainstorming stage, don't be afraid to make assumptions. All right, so I've got a link out to a video about assumptions in engineering design. It's actually really good, but again, you're not going to be able to function at some point if you don't make some assumptions. But just be upfront about those assumptions and understand when you're making assumptions and get those assumptions, ask about those assumptions sooner rather than later. So if something is based on an assumption and you can't verify it, depending on how critical that element is to your design, then you need to go ahead and nail down and figure out whether that assumption is valid or not. And then at some point, you need to move forward. You can wind up spending a lot of time kind of going through evaluating and refining your initial design ideas, but you should be moving forward and getting information, finding those constraints, finding the, a lot of times this has to do with other geometry. So maybe model the current state or model the envelope where your part's going to be mounted or how it's going to work with other parts. So you've got to move forward. And again, at some point, you're going to need to test some of these assumptions. And some of that testing of assumption actually involves an actual physical test. And you may not have the entire design nailed down, but there may be some part. I put in here mini test because sometimes there is some element to your design that you can go ahead and test. It may be the entire thing, not quite developed, but you might check on some assumptions, run some short tests, and see what the results of those look like. Also, it's a good idea at this sort of stage to at least, if you're not formally doing FMEA, which is failure modes and effects analysis, you should at least sort of informally be thinking in your mind, all right, if this element of the design fails, what are going to be some of the effects? How could it fail, and what are going to be some of the effects of it, and see sort of where the critical pieces of your design are. But FMEA, you could do a whole course on that. You should at least look it up and know what it's talking about. Maybe see some example FMEA analyses. And depending on the industry that you're in, there may be a lot more involved in this sort of moving forward than just coming up with a design. All right, and then at some point you need to start really testing in earnest. More and more, you try to approach more and more your finalized design. And sometimes we'll talk here in a second about the fact that it requires may require hard tooling. So what you want to do is make sure before you go to hard tooling that you've tested everything that you can feasibly test without actually having tooling built, because tooling is a pretty expensive step forward. Anyway, once you've gotten this thing, the design verified, then you will implement it. And a lot of times that involves actually ordering tooling, specifying tooling, working with tooling engineers, and then getting tooling to actually work. So a lot of times you get a tooling in, and in its first embodiment, you try to do a trial run of it, and you see that you need to round some corners and things like that. So you get the tooling worked in. And, you know, this used to involve sort of this throwing the design over the wall to production and letting them deal with it. But now, now things work in a lot more concurrent way. So things happen a little bit more in parallel nowadays, where hopefully production and tooling engineers are involved all the way back up here, identifying the problem and brainstorming solutions. And then I like to add on here, evaluate. So once your product has been implemented, whatever it is, don't just sit and wait for feedback to come to you. Go out and actually ask about it. So talk to marketing, talk to the warranty department, okay, depending on how big the company is. But show an interest and find out how you can improve on the next go-round. Now, I will point out that a lot of times this engineering design process is not as tidy as you might want it to be, okay? A lot of times this involves several people, sometimes in completely different locations, working on this thing simultaneously. This is one reason that I have you doing the Stirling engine project. If I gave that Stirling engine to a single individual, one person could model that Stirling engine with very little problem at all. But when you divide it up among peoples, that makes it actually more difficult. And I want you to get an idea for that. And I want you to bear in mind how simple that Stirling engine project actually is. Go out and go pop the hood on your car, okay? And see what some real world complexity looks like. This little Stirling engine, very, very simple product. And I just want you to see how difficult it is to manage all of that information. And I will point out, I will link you out here, there's a video on the product called Team Center. Now in Memphis, there is a lot going on in the world of medical device manufacturing, like implants and things like that. And whether or not a company in Memphis uses Team Center, they almost all will know about it, okay? And it is one example of they'll bundle this together and sell it along with something like NX or Solid Edge. And it is a product lifecycle management tool, or PLM tool, and also NX is sold as a PLM tool, product lifecycle management. Because this is such a difficult task to get everyone to communicate and make sure that you've got the best information moving forward, I want you to go out and look at Team Center and see some examples of Team Center. This is a seminar on sort of introduction to Team Center. Very much worth watching. I will link to it on the course, or I'll link out to the slides, which will have the link in here. Highly recommend that you know what Team Center is before you go interview for a job. Especially if it's at one of these medical device manufacturers, because it's a big deal. And whether you actually have experience with Team Center or not, you need to know what it is. You need to know how it works, because it helps to get everybody on the same page, and it helps to do the job of documenting what you're doing as you move forward. You need to, if you are involved in any role in the engineering design process, you need to keep a notebook. The actual format of the notebook, basically up to you, but look up some good engineering notebooks, and as you move forward with your design, whatever role you're playing, you need to keep a notebook. Right, so the thing that moves the design forward, that gets things started, is understanding the problem. All right, you need to know the problem itself, you need to know the constraints, and you need to know sort of the scope. That is, you know, what are the boundaries of this project? Is it, you know, is it going to involve one product line or many product lines? Is it only your residential product, or is it only your commercial product? Sort of know where are the boundaries of this project. What, how big is the problem that you're trying to solve? What are the constraints? Cost constraints, time constraints, environment. And I'll just say, expect these to not be very well defined. Okay, so somebody might ask you to solve a problem and they may not really know what the problem is themselves. All right. Or what the solution might potentially look at. So I had somebody come into my office several years ago. It actually worked out to be a really interesting project, but they really didn't have much in their hands. They had sort of this little piece of a flexible elastomer, which I guess is redundant, but they had this elastomeric material, and they were going to grow some cells on this material, and they wanted to find a way to stretch it out equally in all directions. So they had this disc and they wanted to be able to expand it. And that's, you know, that's good. So I can start to work with that. But you see, immediately, you have to start asking some questions. And, you know, eventually it came out, well, yes, we want to actually image this, these cells as they're being stretched. And so that's okay. So how are you going to image them? Well, we're going to use a light microscope. And so if you're going to use a light microscope, well, that tells me all of a sudden that my apparatus has to have a big hole in the bottom so the light can shine up through it. And it also is going to limit the size of the apparatus. And so I need to know how big this thing is. I need to know how you're going to image it. And then and also they tell me, oh, yeah, and by the way, we'd also like to image it on an atomic force microscope. So that makes things a little more exciting. So And later it comes out, yeah, we'd actually like to grow the cells while this thing is in situ on the device. So the device has to be able to go into an incubator. All right, well, now I have to know what's the environment of the incubator like, you know, 100% relative humidity and what are the temperatures and things like that. The more you find out about this, is the more you're able to move forward. So I can start to select materials and things like that. And, you know, how are we going to actuate it? Well, this actually needs to be, it's a CNC-controlled device, ideally, or we want to be able to move it some amount. We want to be able to program how this thing flexes. So, you know, you're not just going to be given all the information that you need. Sometimes you have to go out and actively pursue it. All right, so sometimes it's a good idea to think outside the box. But let me tell you this. First of all, you need to know the box. Okay, you need to know what are the conventional ways of solving the problem. Before you go out and come up with some, you know, I don't want to say nutty idea. What I mean is an unconventional idea. You need to be aware of what the conventional ways of solving the problem are. Because if you don't understand why things are done the way that they're done, then your thinking out of the box is much more likely to fail. Okay, so know the box before you think outside it. This should probably be rule number one of product design. Okay, cover your butt. Do not go out and guess about things. That will come back and bite you. All right. You need to know engineering design is a series of decisions, okay? And any decision that you make, you need to be able to back it up, be able to defend any decision that you make. Don't make any decision that you don't have the credentials to make, okay? If you don't know anything about electrical engineering, then don't be sizing transformers, okay? So Any decision that you make, be able to defend it. Back it up. Here's why I chose butyl rubber instead of silicone. Okay, so you'll be able, don't just say, well, I chose butyl rubber. because it was in the catalog and it was inexpensive or something. Okay, you know, that may be a valid reason, maybe not. All right, make your decisions based on authoritative information. Earlier in the semester, we did a project where I asked you to make it out of 10-gauge steel. And when you Google how thick is 10-gauge steel, you get a wrong answer. Okay, that's one reason I ask about it. At least the last time I did it, and for at least a year now, I've been getting the wrong answer as the answer to the question. When you Google how thick is 10-gauge steel, Google will give you an answer from Cornell Law School that references an 1890-something document. It is wrong. So engineering design information should come from authoritative sources like ASTM, ASME, SME, SAE, ISO, all right? Authoritative sources. So make sure that you get as absolutely close as you can to an authoritative source. I will tell you, there's a lot of people at your future place of employment who will give you what they think is correct information. Sometimes they're right, sometimes they're not. Okay, but make sure, you know, if they are the authoritative source, then that's, you know, then you go with that. But you need to be able to verify these things. I like to say, don't be an ass, ask. All right, if you don't know something, ask about it. You cannot do engineering design and be just an absolute introvert who does not go out and ask questions. You cannot just, you know, don't just guess. Okay, so also, you're going to make assumptions, okay? Notice that I'm not telling you not to make assumptions. Now, maybe it's a valid assumption, maybe it's not. Let me ask you about this assumption. I've had people go out, and so they understand that we have a laser cutter, and so they'll spend, this has happened in the past, okay? They've gone out and they've bought some kind of steel or something, and they want to cut it with the laser cutter. Well, guess what? Our laser cutter does not cut steel. It doesn't cut any kind of metal. We have a plasma cutter that can cut steel. We have a plasma cutter that can cut aluminum, but it doesn't cut it with the sort of with the accuracy that a laser would. Okay, so don't assume that you're going to be able to buy a piece of material and go down and put it in the laser and have the laser cut this stuff. Now they do have, you know, lasers that will cut steel and aluminum. And in fact, they have those locally. You can pay somebody to do that, but you're not going to be able to do it here. So don't assume that you know, that the material you're working with is going to work with the equipment and things like that. So when you realize that you're making an assumption, document it. Put it in writing. Make sure that it's in a checklist somewhere that it gets verified and that you ask about it. Tie those loose ends up. Also, if a large part of your design is going to be based on an assumption, there's some assumptions you won't be able to nail down. Whoever are the stakeholders need to know about the assumption that you're making. They may be able to verify the assumption, or they may not. But for goodness sakes, they need to know that what you're doing is based on an assumption. All right, so this is a general rule, okay? It's something that you do to become a better designer. And it's more involved in your daily routine than in the routine of doing a specific design. You need to know about your job. You need to know the context of your job, and you need to know how to do your job, and you need to learn something about how to do your job better every day, okay? If you're in engineering design, then you need to learn a little something about engineering design every single day. There's no reason not to. Forego some of the social media and go into more of a study about how to do your job better every day. So if you're learning, if you're like working on NX like we've been working, there is something that you can learn about NX every day for the rest of your life. It is a huge, huge program. Know the industry that you work in. Know the company. Know your company history. Know who the management of the company is. Understand your company and understand your company's competition. Know the people in the marketing department. If you're doing engineering design, then there is a very good reason for you to know these people's first names, okay? You should be communicating with them. They should be communicating with you or your boss, okay? So if you're not in a position to know these people, then it should be very soon that you're getting to know these people, all right? They should be in the meetings that you're going to. Learn their names, respect these people, and get information from them. Also, know your customer, and also know your end user. Sometimes your users are not the people who are your customers. An example is, I used to work in this industry. This is an example of a project that I worked on. This is the Terex RL4000. I worked for Coleman Engineering, which was a company that was acquired by Terex. But we made these diesel-powered generator sets and light towers and things like that. And the people that bought this stuff are the rental companies. So rental companies are, they go out and they buy a bunch of equipment. They rent it out. Well, the people that buy the equipment are not the people that are using the equipment. All right? So, it's the best people I found to talk to were the people at the rental houses, Hertz and Allman Brothers, not the band, but anyway, these rental companies, the people to talk to were the maintenance people, all right, because they knew the most about this equipment because they weren't just a one-time user that used it once or twice. They were on this stuff every day. So if you've got a chance to talk to people that worked in the maintenance company at your customer, then you got some really first-class information from those folks. So, that's really a job of marketing. In a smaller company, though, the marketing company may just be involved in sales, and they're doing more of a job of sales than marketing, but they're going to be more in tune with these people probably than you. But ask to go along. Ask to go to trade shows. Trade shows are a great place to learn about your industry, your company, and your competition. And probably the marketing people will be there too. And also, maybe your customers and sometimes the end users will be at trade shows. It's just good to be in touch and listen to people, listen to them complain. That is, if you have a way as a designer to get a hold of complaints that might be going through marketing, that's a brilliant source of information. All right. Let's see. Know your suppliers. Know the people that are in the manufacturing. Know the people that are putting the stuff together. Know the tool designers or the fab shops that might be making your stuff or the machine shops that might be making your stuff. I remember I was working. I was doing some tool design for a company at one time. And the shop that made our tooling, these punches, I thought they were making these things on a lathe. Well, I went down to visit that shop, and as we were talking to the guy that ran the shop, he was showing me how he made the punches, and it wasn't a lathe at all. He was using a plunge EDM to make these cylindrical parts. And when I learned that, that opened up a whole new realm of possibilities for me. Stuff that if I knew it was going to be made on an EDM, it suddenly made a lot of different things that I could do with that tooling almost free. All right, so one of your big constraints, whether anybody mentions it or not, is going to be cost, and they probably will mention it. So just be expecting whoever's in charge of this project to be on you to get as much cost as you possibly can out of it. All right, that's not because they don't like quality. I've heard that so many times that, well, these people just aren't concerned with quality. They want me to not design it the way I want it because they don't like, they just don't understand engineering. They don't understand quality. And that's poppycock, okay? They are in business. You are being paid by these people to turn a profit. Okay, you are not in business to make the world a better place. As much as I wish that were true, it's not. Okay, so if your design is not profitable, then you're not doing a very good job. All right, so cost is always going to be a factor. Not only the product cost, but also the development cost. Okay, so let's look at the development cost and the cost of a change. So this is sort of the traditional cost of a change diagram. As you move through up here, these are sort of napkin sketches, and as you're trying to flesh out the design, not a whole lot of cost is associated with that. I won't say that it's zero cost, however. It looks like it's zero on here, because you're being paid to look at those napkin sketches. You're being paid to do that brainstorming. Okay, so money's going out during this period, but it's very cheap to make a change at this point. If it's on a whiteboard, you can put a fillet on the whiteboard very cheaply. You can move holes around in CAD very cheaply. So you can change the size of a hole in CAD very cheaply. But as this progresses forward, maybe you've got a multi-part assembly, like maybe you've got like on the Stirling engine, maybe you decide to change the number of fasteners or something, and all of a sudden the holes have to change, and maybe the holes, maybe that means that multiple parts have to be changed. You have to redesign multiple parts. That starts to have a cost to it. And you see, as this thing gets further along, eventually you get the parts out on the field, and you realize that something's wrong and has to change. You see how this thing goes up exponentially. Those can be very, very expensive when changes get out into the field. Think of Firestone or the GM ignition problem. The Firestone problem some of these problems almost bankrupted these companies. This is how I prefer to think of this cost of a change, though, because there's this big jump in here about tooling. All right, so this is tooling cost as it comes along. So there's going to be a point in your design where you have to move forward, you have to invest in tooling. And so that's why I put this little stepwise deal in here, because there's going to be a jump if you progress to tooling. If you start making changes after tooling, man, it ought to be just a whole nother jump up, okay? You probably get another one of these jumps. If you have to redo the tooling, then you're going to pay out the butt for that tooling the second time. Hopefully it only needs to be modified at worst case. But once you go to tooling, man, things get expensive. All right, so look also at the development cost. This is a thing that gets called the PLM, Product Lifecycle Management Curve. And this is where you live as a designer. Okay, if you're doing engineering design and product design, you live here. Okay, you're a liability on the company because you're involved in the activity that you're involved in is totally associated with a negative income. All right. In fact, to ever make positive income, you have to first start making sales, and you don't get up into the positive until you've sold enough sales to earn back the area under this curve down here. Okay, so this is actually a little bit optimistic. So what you want to do is shorten this gap in here. You want to move forward to sales as quickly as you can, and efficiently. You don't want to make a cost of change. You don't want to have to change something after you've released a product. That gets very expensive very fast, but you want to minimize this gap in here. And that means getting people on board doing concurrent engineering. That means talking to people in tooling, talking to marketing, talking to everyone that you can early on, and for goodness sakes, not goofing off. If you're doing engineering design and your boss walks in and you're on Facebook or Reddit or whatever, that's not going to go down very well, because you are not only are you in this negative, costing the company money, but your hour of Facebook just pushed this whole sales thing out an hour, okay? And that means everybody associated with this, all of the equipment that's being purchased for this, and the you know, the lease that's paid on that and the space in the facility where the product line is going to be that's gotten cleared out and that's being paid, that they're paying rent on, all of that got extended an hour, all right, and maybe more. So if you're in this industry, it's very important that you do not be seen goofing off. You know, some industries, that's not a big deal. If you're a security guard, it's not as big a deal, all right? But if you're doing engineering design, and I'm not picking on security guards, but, you know, something like that. If you're a librarian, it's okay if you do some of this in your off time, maybe. You're not pushing out, you know, you're not causing hundreds of thousands of dollars in delays if you're a librarian. All right. More constraints, all right? Available suitable materials. So you need to know sort of what is the application demand of a material? What's are sort of the environmental elements that this thing's exposed to? Is it going to be in the sunlight? Is it going to be under the hood of a car where the hot, it's very hot and it gets very cold and there's petroleum being sprayed around? So you need to know sort of what the environment demands, but you also need to know that not any material is going to be available. You need to know the materials that you actually can get from your suppliers. I will tell you a story on myself. I designed a product many years ago that I found the perfect plastic was a 4/6 nylon, and it was just going to be perfect. And the thing is, I couldn't find anybody in the United States, and it was harder to find people in those days. This was pre-internet. That could mold this particular nylon that I found. Okay, so I was buying it out of or specifying it out of a design guide, and there it was, and it was something that that was in the catalog, but nobody in the United States was using this stuff, and it made things very difficult. So learn from that. Know what you can actually buy before you spend too much time moving forward with it. Shop as you specify. See, I made an assumption that I could buy the product that was in the catalog, and that was not a valid assumption, all right? Just because it's in the catalog, and I'll tell you, the same thing happens with, like, steel catalogs. It's maybe not as big a deal these days because you have the internet, but you need to know whether or not this stuff is something that you can buy before you spend too much time buying it. This thing down here about the hardware stores are not a good source in general. That is mostly for senior project, okay? Because once you get out in industry, you get sort of in touch with who the suppliers are. In senior project, it's better to shop online. I'll just say that. Hardware stores are real good if you have a construction-related project. But in general, they really are pretty limited in terms of the materials that you can buy and components that you can buy there. A good site to know about, I'll just plug McMaster Car. They are a little pricey, but by golly, they've got the stuff. Okay, so if you need a brick of tungsten, maybe, then look up McMaster Car. They'll probably be able to put it in your hands. All right. Also, as you're designing, know the processes that are going to be used for your product. Know, is it injection molding? Is it compression molding? Is it some kind of deep drawing? Know the equipment and the processes. Know the constraints that come from the equipment, from the processes themselves. Okay, and design to those. Or if you're not going to be making the stuff in-house, talk to your supplier. If you're going to have something made with powder metallurgy or injection molding, talk with the people who are going to be designing the molding, the tooling for those processes, and they will be an excellent source for you. Know the environment where the product is going to be installed or where it's going to be used. All right. If you don't know that, it's going to be very difficult to design. Standards and regulatory constraints. All right, again, the medical device industry, it just absolutely runs on regulatory information. Okay, so I mean, everything is controlled and has to be tracked. You know, there are ASTM standards, no matter, you know, whatever the industry is that you're in, there's going to be some kind of regulatory information. You need to understand that regulatory information and, you know, read the standards that apply and understand what those standards are talking about. It's a huge deal. Performance characteristics. These are the things that you kind of automatically expect to drive your design, and they should. And I'm just trying to focus on maybe the things that are not so obvious. All right. People have been giving you design tools your whole life. Okay, when you started off in elementary school and you learned how to count, and when you were in middle school and you learned how to use the Cartesian coordinates system, they were teaching you engineering design. You've been given all of these tools and working on these tools your entire academic career. Use them, for heaven's sakes. Okay. Maybe you don't like geometry or proofs or something like that. You're missing out. Okay. Because those things are tools to help you design. Physics class, tools to help you design. It's not just something you go out and just learn about. They're giving you the fundamentals of how to do a design, how to model things mathematically, and how to model them in CAD. So use these things. In senior project, we are telling you that it's not about the product. It's not the widget that you make. It's not about the thing. It's about using the tools. So keep your notes, keep your books, go back and look at the stuff that you were doing. Look at example problems from other classes. Look at examples from physics. Look at examples from your statics and strengths of materials. And you know, if you're not seeing it, then try to find, if you don't automatically see it, try to find some element, try to come up with a sample problem for one of the concepts in one of those classes. You know, what we want to see is analysis. We want to see you using the tools that you've learned, all right? So it's not about the thing. Senior project is not about the device. It's not about the widget. This is not Craft Camp. It's not Votech. It is learning how to apply engineering problem-solving tools to solve engineering problems. All right, right size the features. That includes understanding clearance and tolerance and allowance and interference. All right, tolerance is the allowable deviation. So like on this screw thread, that screw needs to fit. It needs to have the size that fits within this tolerance zone. Allowance is a type of clearance. All right, a clearance is a type of allowance. Sorry, so this type of allowance, this gap in here, is clearance. Now, in some cases, like with a press fit, you want to have overlap. In that case, the allowance is called interference. So clearance and interference are two types of allowance. Tolerance is how much the size of the part can actually change, how much deviation is tolerable, how much is permissible for the design to work. If you ever have a shaft and a hole that are fit together, understand what is the right size hole for that. Look up limits and fits and understand about how limits and fits. We talk about that in 4571 in the tool design class. I will link out to it so that you'll have access to that. Let me just say this, that you're going to want to do this when you're working on your Stirling engine. You think, well, I need these two parts to fit together, so I'll just press fit them. All right, I'll just smash them together. That is not usually an appropriate way to assemble things. So press fitting works in very limited certain circumstances, but if you need something to fit on a gear onto a shaft, something like that, there are generally better ways than press fitting. Press fitting is, like I said, it's sometimes the right thing to do, but not usually Not a whole lot of things are press fit together. I mean, especially things that need to be able to be disassembled. All right, hull locations. You know, you can have them too close together. You can have them too close to the edge, things like that. And the actual product that you're designing will probably have, you know, there's probably something in the design guide about hull locations. But do keep in mind that just because you put a hull in the right place and the holes line up in the assembly doesn't mean you're going to be able to get that hex head screw or hex head bolt through the hole. You know, you got to allow access for the head of that thing, plus the wrench that goes on the outside of that. So sometimes it's good to even model like a wrench so that you can see what the clearances are. All right. I have seen a lot of engineering design that is based on wishful thinking. All right. This is what wishful thinking looks like. Okay. I take this piece, this piece of wood and this other piece of wood, and I put a fastener through here and I tighten it up and I hope that friction will do its job and this thing won't pull down. Okay. Also, putting things onto an axle. I've seen an awful lot of wishful thinking about that. Maybe if I press fit it on there, it'll work. No, there are really good ways of putting something on an axle and getting it so that either it spins or it doesn't spin, or it spins and it translates along the length of the axle, things like that. There are good, solid, conventional ways of doing that. Be familiar with those things. You do not have to just pull all of this out of your head. Go out and look and see how other people solved the problem, okay? Know about four-bar linkages. See, this is not a four-bar linkage, but if you had four bars here, then that wouldn't add any support at all, okay? So don't use friction to do this job right here. This is friction doing geometry's job. This is geometry doing the right job. This is how to use geometry correctly. This is using friction the wrong way. And this is just sort of just a single example, but I've seen it a lot where you're relying on wishful thinking. Don't rely on wishful thinking. Also, design joints for the joining method. All right, like don't glue a butt joint. This is just a reminder that Tech 3401 was a design class. Also, your dynamics class is a design class. That means that if you're designing something, you should be able to go to this class, go to your notes, find examples. The examples in 3401 should appear. You should have free body diagrams in your senior project. Okay, that analysis should be there. All right, know your dynamics. That was another design class. All right, if two parts are going to rub past each other, do something to mitigate the friction. For heaven's sakes, don't have two aluminum parts rubbing on each other. Don't have two stainless steel parts rubbing on each other. Have a bushing, have a nylon bushing or a brass bushing or a ball bearing in between those things. All right, think these things out. Again, this is another place where you see wishful thinking, where you have two parts. You're going to have a shaft that's going to rotate inside of something, and you just hope that it doesn't bind up. All right, just expect it to bind up if you don't do something about it. Also, when you may do a calculation, you may get a spec sheet on a motor, and it might say that it's an eighth of a horsepower, and that might be exactly what you calculated. I'll just tell you, that eighth of a horsepower is optimistic and it doesn't have anything to do with any inefficiencies along the way. So the drivetrain is going to eat up efficiency and you're going to need extra power. So you'll want a motor that's going to do the job, a motor that you know is going to do the job. So, you know, you can oversize things, but, you know, as a general rule, it's not the right size until it's a little bit oversized. Understand about stress risers and ridiculous things like this, where you have a really abrupt change in cross-sectional area, and you also here have a sharp corner. Sharp corners are bad. You know about those things. Eliminate those things. Think, you know, go back, look at your 3401 notes about stress concentrations. Use symmetry unless there's a good reason not to use symmetry. align holes with each other unless there's a good reason not to align them. If you're designing a control panel or something, line the things up. Make them look good. Know what you can buy. Know what you can go out and buy. And also know what you can adapt. So this was an example of a project that I worked on, and it was designed to use existing tooling to design this joint. So I'm not reinventing the tooling. I knew that we could make this because we were already making some of these profiles, and so I was able to adapt them. Also, look at the catalogs. Know what's available. Don't go out and reinvent the wheel. Don't go out and reinvent the toggle clamp. Okay, you buy toggle clamps. You buy nuts and bolts in general, just as a rule. You're generally not saving any money if you're going through all the problem to design this stuff that's already been designed, and have somebody in the shop make it when you could have just ordered it for what might have seemed expensive, but it's probably a fraction of the cost of what it would take to get it designed in-house. Speaking of design, if you're using any kind of design guide, you should know that design guides exist. So whether if you're injection molding something, there's some really excellent injection molding design guides, and what you want to do is find the design guide for the actual resin that you're going to be molding. It's probably out there. You have to go look for it, though. This is a design guide for fluid power seals. Okay, so be aware that these helps exist. You didn't have to learn all this in school. All right, there are design guides that people that make this stuff, they want it to be successful. Okay, and so find the design guides, know what's out there, and know how to apply them. Simplify things. Limit the number of fastener types that you're using. You know, maybe you have a design that has several different fastener designs. Maybe you could oversize a few of them and go with a single fastener, for instance. And in general, it's better to have a lower part count. But that's only in general. Sometimes you actually want a higher part count to make things simpler to make. But in general, the fewer parts, the better. This is an example of something that might be better off as two parts. But what I was going to talk about here is design for manufacturing. It's real easy in NX to model any shape you want. All right, but keep in mind, if you're going to model a shape like this, you're going to have to start with some material. If we're talking about not just modeling it, but making it. To actually make a part like this, what are you going to do? Buy a big, giant chunk of aluminum and then machine away all of this other stuff. Okay, consider this stuff when you're designing in CAD. Think about what is the real world piece of stock that I'm going to use, that I'm going to modify to get into this shape. And somebody said, well, I'll just cast it in that shape. No, that's a ridiculous casting. It doesn't work that way. All right, so understand the processes, understand the materials, understand what standard industrial stock is available. All right, also, some other design, these are design methodologies. Design for assembly is a good one. And it depends on your field, but sometimes you want something to be able to be assembled with all the fasteners driven in from one direction, especially if you have automated assembly equipment, things like that. Real good idea to think about maintenance and disassembly. Have a robust design. Understand the difference between this and this, okay? Parallel reliability versus serial reliability. In this case, if one of these parts fails, it's okay. It's redundant. You have redundant systems here. In this chain, if one of these parts fails, then the whole thing fails. Okay, so that's something that maybe you're not always able to physically replicate or implement. But for heaven's sakes, it's a good way to think, okay, to understand this concept. All right, and then be able to think critically about your design. So once your design is implemented and the thing is being used, go back and ask people that are using it about it, about their experience with it. What's working? What's not working? What was easy about it? What was hard about it? Okay, you have to go out sometimes and get that feedback. Look for that feedback. ask for that feedback. Don't expect it just to come to you. If you really screw up, it'll come to you. But if you only kind of screw up, you might never hear about it. And so think critically about it. Understand that you're not perfect, and think about what could have been done differently, what could be done better. And then finally, understand that the engineering design process very rarely has nice, neat closure, all right? A lot of times throughout the life cycle of a product, there will be changes. You might have a supplier that no longer supplies the particular hinge that you specified, and you have to go and make a change, things like that. Or there might be a warranty issue, and you might need to make an adjustment, might need to make changes. All of that information, talking about making changes, we could have a whole nother discussion on engineering design changes. I would say go out and watch that video about Team Center and understand how important it is to keep track of all this information and to be able to leverage all of what you put into the first design into derivative products, for example, products that are based on the product that you designed. If you did a real good job of documenting your design experience the first time, then you can leverage that and make bigger strides the next time and shorten that development time and be more successful, do better designs faster. Anyway, that's all I've got, and we'll talk to you later.